movie called The China Hustle, and what it does is it profiles Dan David, who is the guy I worked for at Geo Investing, and Carson Block, a couple other short sellers and kind of like fraud investigators. And what a lot of these people have done is they went and did research on companies that purported to be operating in China and that were trading on U.S. stock exchanges. And what we found was that a lot of these companies didn't even exist. Some of them didn't exist the way the company said. Some of them, the factories were just shut down. And they were just perpetuating a huge fraud on U.S. capital markets. So if you want to know more about that story, and there's a lot more about it, the movie's called The China Hustle. I think you can find it on like Amazon Prime. It's worth a watch. It's like an hour and a half. That'll explain that. The point I'm trying to make with that is that the Chinese are very, very shrewd. They are very smart. They are very shrewd. They are very surgical in the way that they do business. They see a loophole and they exploit it, which is essentially what that movie's about. It's about, you know, how the U.S. exchanges and auditors missed all of these problems, which allowed them, you know, even with luck and coffee last year was a huge fraud that came out of China. And there's many other ones listed on U.S. exchanges now that have yet to blow up. But the Chinese and the Chinese government are very, very shrewd. They're way smarter than we are. And some things I like about Trump, other things I don't like about him. But I will say that his hawkishness on China, I think, was one of his biggest assets, because we have no clue how shrewd they are. I just got a little taste of it. I got a little taste of it from working with some Chinese nationals that were very smart, that were able to give me some insight, you know, other analysts, from just doing, you know, moderate research on businesses, on universities, on state-owned entities that were tied into the Chinese Communist Party. China doesn't fuck around, man. It is not a, you know, they're not out trying to be friends with the world. They're trying to do what's best for China. And over here, we're having this debate about whether or not they're our friends.
Yeah.
You know, fucking our president right now is doing business with them.
And he called them an ally.
That thing that broke before the election about Hunter Biden and Joe Biden doing business with China is one of the biggest scandals in political history, and nobody even paid attention to it. Matter of fact, you couldn't tweet about it, you couldn't Facebook about it, you couldn't do any of this shit, because immediately your shit would be taken down from social media. But that was one of the biggest political scandals of all time. You have, you know, everybody barked and bitched and whined for 4 years about Trump and Russia. We brought in an objective guy, Robert Mueller. Everybody was happy Mueller was doing it, the left and the right. What did Mueller find out? Fuck all, right? He found out all this whining and bitching and moaning for 4 years and impeachment and Trump and Putin. You know, there was no collusion. There was nothing there. Meanwhile, this other fucking guy who's our president now is literally transacting with Chinese state-owned entities, Chinese businesses, the Chinese government. And nobody seems to care. Nobody's even talking about it. So the media is doing the country a horrible disservice. We both know that. That goes to your other question before. You're like, well, what are people missing, people in Hollywood? Well, you know, you got your choice. They watch fucking MSNBC, ABC, or CNN, and they all report the same shit. Unless you're watching Fox News or OAN, which I know people don't even have, or you're tuning into a podcast, you know, you're getting the story that the media is pushing out there, and they have an agenda. So the idea that, you know, we need to kind of couch China and make sure that they're, you know, our friends. I'm sure we can be friends with them, but it has to come from a place of respect. We can't be China's fucking doormat. And unfortunately, right now, with the way that the global economy is set up, we are extremely reliant on China for everything. You saw it during COVID when we tried to get some drugs here. We were trying to get hydroxychloroquine or the base ingredients we needed for it. And we couldn't even produce the drug here because we didn't even have the factories. Fucking everything comes from China. Everything. And if at some point they say, hey, you know what? We're going to consume this stuff domestically. We're not going to give it to you anymore. We're issuing a digital yuan, which is their currency, and we're going to back it with gold. And we're going to sell our U.S. treasuries, which I don't even know why they're still buying U.S. treasuries, probably so they can just dump them all at some point and hit the bid all at once. But if they were to do those things, that would cripple us. I mean, it would be, there would be some austerity for them too, But it feels to me like that's the direction they're moving in. And I think China is going to be the next superpower. They already are. They're definitely not a developing nation. But I think China could very well dethrone the U.S. as the most powerful country in the world relatively soon if things continue to move the way that they are. And we continue to have elected officials that don't realize, you know, that if you've never done the research, if you've never looked at the veracity of the fraud that's been committed, if you've never looked at the intellectual property that's been stolen by China, if you've never looked deeply into the fact that, you know, the cameras that we have inside the Pentagon, okay, we have Hikvision cameras inside the Pentagon. These are Chinese-made cameras. People say, oh, what are they going to do? Put a backdoor in the firmware that allows the Chinese government to look in the Pentagon? That's crazy. No, it's not. They're not dumb. You know what I mean? That's exactly the kind of shit they would do. You can't put that fucking shit past them. So I think until our elected officials understand that, and by the way, if you want to read about this, the Wall Street Journal has done great write-ups. If you search for Wall Street Journal and Huawei and Hikvision and China and intellectual property, they've done incredible series about theft of intellectual property. That's part of what we're seeing right now with Tesla. Tesla is doing business in China, right? What do you have to do business in China? Well, you kind of have to make a deal with the devil, right? They've gotten this great terms, this great new factory over there. The Chinese government was eager to give them money. And then all of a sudden, you know, at unwonderful terms. And there was just a report like 2 weeks ago that the Chinese subsidiary of Tesla in Shanghai is starting to do all of its business in Chinese now. It used to all be in English, right? Because they're an American company. And they've hired, their PR person now is a former CCP state representative who managed PR for the Chinese Communist Party. And the guy who is the head of the subsidiary is somebody who's like also directly connected underneath the CCP. And so, you know, there was this big article about how, okay, everybody's speaking Chinese there now. All the emails are in Mandarin. Nothing is done in English anymore. And that's just part of what I think is them turning that into a state-owned enterprise. They're going to funnel out the intellectual property from it.
They'll probably use it
as SAIC or some other. I'm sorry.
Tesla?
Tesla, yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, I'll find the. Hang on one sec. I'll find it.
You would think that that's something that. I mean, I didn't hear about this until now. And he just did Rogan. You know, he's all over the place talking about the Cybertruck. You know, it's going to be built in Texas at the Austin plant. And
dude, Elon Musk is one of the biggest con men of our generation. And I could go into depth about what I mean by that, but that's just my opinion. I think.
I don't know if you can say that and not go into depth. I would love to, because there's a ton of people in the automotive world that do not like Elon Musk.
That's correct, because he is a bit of a charlatan. Let me just see if I can find this.
I heard that.
Here it is. Elon Musk's Chinese fairy tale will eventually come to an end. So here's an article to read. This is on Zero Hedge. It's called Elon Musk's Chinese fairy tale will eventually come to an end. And this article lays out, and also there's a Bloomberg Business Week piece on it called China's Favorite Capitalist. How long will Elon Musk's romance with Beijing last?
Mm.
And this article lays out all of kind of what's going on in China. So you can read that.
Damn. Yes.
So it's safe to say that a lot of these companies, when you're operating in China, if it's a Chinese company, they have a direct link to the CCP. In other words, the CCP can access and kind of like tell them what to do. And I heard that anytime we allow Chinese telecom to set up some towers and stuff here stateside, in essence, that's part of, it's almost like their military now has towers in our land, and they're just kind of like infiltrating and surrounding and just taking over every aspect. And it's like a crazy game of chess, man.
That's why Huawei just got kicked out of Australia, and why there's this big debate in the U.S. about do we want to use Huawei products here, right? Because we're essentially allowing them to just install infrastructure here in the U.S.
Mm-hmm.
People say, oh, they would never do something like use that to spy on us. It's like, fuck yeah, they would. You know what I mean? We're not talking fucking rinky-dink first grade, you know, playing hide-and-seek. This is global international espionage. You know, it takes course over 20, 30, 50, 100 years. These are, you know, global spy games, right? This is not like a couple people fucking around, you know, one neighbor spying on another neighbor. Every couple weeks go by, you read another article about some professor somewhere. I saw there was a Harvard professor. There was a guy that was working for the New York Police Department, you know, that they had found to be Chinese spies. And wow. They, you know, sent them back to China. But imagine if those are the ones that they're catching, who are the ones that they're not catching? The Democrats, they're, you know, Eric Swalwell was banging one of them, right?
Fang.
Oh, we mention him all the time.
She was a Chinese communist spy, right? So you talk about, like, having the wool pulled over your eyes and not being sharp enough to understand what's going on. They're everywhere. And, you know, Xi Jinping is playing fucking 4D Star Wars style chess. And Joe Biden doesn't even know what fucking day of the week it is.
No.
You know, so it's, is it any wonder? Is it any wonder? I think China will be the next. If we don't wise up, we're going to have some problems. That's the point. I'm sorry.
What kind of comment do you even make to that? Like, yeah, you're right. Yeah, it's true. Here we are talking about it. We try to talk about it 2-3 times a week on our podcast. We listen to other people kind of chat about it. But at the core of it, talking about the nucleus, we have this, our government, who is just wanting to play friendly with these people and seeming like it's not a big deal. I just don't.
And our corporations and our sports leagues and our media, I mean, Disney.
They're all on the take, Chingo.
Yeah, it's all like idea wars. It's all like who can persuade better, whose propaganda is better. Like,
They're all on the take, man. Everybody wants to do business in China.
Yeah, a billion customers.
China. Apple wants to do business in China. The National Basketball Association wants the revenue from China, right?
You're right.
So that's it. They want the money from China.
So it's funny you mentioned Mark Cuban earlier that produced the documentary that you worked on. Was that right?
His company, yeah, Magnolia Pictures produced it. I didn't work on it. I'm not even really in it. I'm in it for like a half second.
Oh, that's funny.
But it's about the company that I worked at.
I think Baby Bladder had to go pee. But so isn't it ironic? Isn't it weird? Because he's kind of constantly in hot water when it comes to the Mavs, the NBA, and China, and, you know, the business dealings and his kind of like laissez-faire approach to maybe, I don't know, American values versus just keeping business with business over there. Do you have any input or opinions on his kind of takes on anything?
Not really.
From that?
I don't know enough about his takes to comment about it, to be honest with you. But I did see this story last week that, you know, he was considering not playing the national anthem before Mavericks games.
Yeah.
And I think that's ridiculous. I think the NBA came in and said, you can't do that anyways. And I also think it was just they were doing it supposedly because there was nobody in the stands.
Right.
But just the fact that there was an idea that he was saying, oh, well, we don't need to play the national anthem before games. Like, look, I'm not Mr. fucking nationalist. I don't salute every flag that I pass when I'm walking down the street.
You're not Johnny Patriotism
country, but I do respect the country. You know, I do respect it. I do respect the nation, and I do respect, you know, the history and what it took for us to get to where we are today. And you know, I have a modicum of respect for my personal quality of life, the things that the country has afforded me, the jobs that, again, my parents have benefited from. They both worked for the government. You know, neither of my parents went to 4-year college. I was the first person in my family to do that. And the opportunity that the country represents. So, you know, you don't need to be, you don't need to be cloaked in the American flag every single day and have this crazy hard on for the country, but you do have to have some respect and you have to have some humility and you need to be humble, I think, to some degree. And I think that that's one of those things that kind of falls under that umbrella. You know, I don't think it's too much to ask for to play the national anthem event. You know, I don't know. It's just, to me, it always seems like a nice moment. Because everybody, no matter who they're rooting for, stands up together. You know, it's a quick reminder that, you know, we're all brothers and sisters here in this country. You know, nobody brings up, you know, their political beliefs or this or that or the other thing or age, race, sex, you know, gender. None of that shit comes up. It's just like, hey, like, we're going to take a second. We're going to remember that we're all Americans. You know, we're going to take a second to honor those that made the country what it is. And that's it. It's 2 minutes, and then fucking play ball, drink your beer, watch the game. Hey, you know what I mean? Get in fist fights with the opposing fans, whatever you want to do.
That's,
you
know, back, it's like, yeah. That's back in simpler times. Yeah. That's back in simpler times when, like...
You think we'll ever get back to that normal?
Well, I think right now it's at a fervor, man. It's like shark-infested waters of everybody trying to politicize everything. No crisis gone to waste. So something like the national anthem, in simpler times, it's like you said, we're going to be humble and appreciate and respectful. But it's become this thing where it's like, yeah, nice of you to have your freedoms, but do you know that there's kids in cages? And did you know that Donald Trump said grab him by the pussy? Did you know that, Rob? Mr. Patriotism?
I did, and I thought it was funny because it was cooler talk. But hey, locker room talk. What did he call it? Locker room talk, I think.
It's locker room talk.
Yeah, locker room talk. Yeah.
Do you think money's going...
He said at one point... Bill Clinton has said much worse things to me on the golf course. and you know that shit's true, too. You know what 100%. I mean? You know fucking Bill Clinton said shit, too.
Bill Clinton said, grab him by the butthole.
By the balloon knot.
Damn,
Bill.
Hey, is money going to go digital? Is that one of the theories? I know you mentioned earlier that the Chinese, was it yuan? They, you know, that could be one of their potential chess moves.
Yeah, well, I think they're already starting to do that. I think every country is starting, you know, all the central banks are starting to experiment with digital money. And so, you know, it's just one more step removed from money backed by anything, right? Mm. You know, dollars used to be, you could take a dollar and you could, you know, go to your Federal Reserve Bank and exchange it for X amount of gold or X amount of silver. And then we went off, you know, the gold and silver standard. And now we just have notes, they're called Federal Reserve notes. And they actually are notes. They're liabilities for the Federal Reserve. So we have these pieces of paper now. And at least you can fucking hold them. You know what I mean? Like, at least you can pick them up and hold them. Like, if you want to hoard some cash at home in the safe, you can actually do that. And digital is just one more step removed from reality. You know, it makes it easier to transact, obviously, but it also, there's a lot of cons that come with the pros, right? The pros are probably makes things a lot easier in terms of transacting, but also, and makes it easier to manipulate the money supply and to control things like velocity of money. And, you know, which would be essentially be like if the Federal Reserve gave you $1,000, which they might do now for stimulus, but if it was digital, they might be able to put a time limit on it and say, dude, you got to spend this in fucking, you know, 5 months or it goes away. Like, that kind of shit can happen with digital money that can't happen with paper money. So, you know, it's one more step removed from a money backed by anything. And there's one of two ways that that can go. One is it's going to be the key to unlocking a utopia going forward, or it's going to eventually result in hyperinflation and a giant elastic swing back toward money that is backed by something that has some tangible value. And so, but I think that, you know, digital currency is inevitable for all the central banks at this point. I think everybody's looking at it. But, you know, it's like, look, you got to, like, I'm one of those people that likes gold and silver. Why? Because it's been widely accepted as money for thousands of years, right? It's got this huge track record, and I can hold it, and you know, you can take it with you. You can, dollars are not gold and silver. They're not, you know, if you think gold and silver is real money, you think dollars aren't real money, but at least you could pick them up and take them somewhere. And if you think dollars are real money, you may not even think that digital money is real money because you can't access it if you don't have power. Like, I find that interesting. That's like a big thing people talk about Bitcoin with. You know, I always say, like, well, what happens if you're in Texas and the power goes out? Like, you might as well not have your fucking Bitcoin at all. Because if you don't have internet access, it doesn't really exist to you. Mm. You know, so it's like, all right. But, you know, maybe it's just, I'm sure for my time period in my life, I'm almost 40. There's going to be things that make sense to me that don't make sense to younger generations. And I think there's probably stuff, you know, that makes sense to guys that are 60, 70, 80 years old that don't make sense to me. So digital currency is just that next iteration, you know?
So when we talk about inflation, by the way, in your opinion, how quickly is what all this money printing is that's happening, how quickly is it going to affect the money that, say, you or I, us, have in our banks, that have in savings, that we have invested? How quickly is that going to diminish or affect that money that we actually have?
So that's a really good question. And it really kind of all depends on which numbers you look at, right? If you look at the government's CPI numbers, or, you know, their PCE numbers, or which are essentially like the government official macroeconomic data on inflation, like how quickly are prices rising? And by that percentage is the amount of purchasing power that your dollar decreases by on an annual basis, right? So if you have $100 now and that loses 2% of its purchasing power every year, next year, your $100 bill is only going to be able to buy you what $98 the year prior would have been able to buy you. Even though it's still $100, it has less purchasing power. It has less value, right? It's got less bang for the buck, to use an expression. So if you don't look at the government's numbers and you just take some inventory in your own life, look at, you know, things in your own life, like I've done, like many other people have done, there's this great index online called the Chapwood Index, which basically takes a basket of 500 consumer items and looks at their prices over the course of several years. What they see, and what people like myself that examine these things by looking at the price of a Budweiser, or looking at the price that my HOA at my condo costs, or looking at the price for an oil change for my car, generally what you see is prices are rising between like 9% and 10% a year. Which stands at stark odds with what the government tells us, which is that, you know, prices are rising maybe 1% a year right now, or 1.5%. And they have this target for 2% or 2.5%.
What is that source again?
The reason for that is several.
What is that? Buddy? What is that website, or what was it, where you can see, look this up?
It's called the Chapwood Index, C-H-A-P-W-O-O-D, Chapwood Index.
Okay.
And it's really cool. It breaks down the cost of living in like, and it's really easy to understand too. It breaks down the cost of living in like, I think the top 50 or 100 major cities in the country. And then it shows you a basket of items that they use to track the prices. And it's everything from, you know, getting an oil change, to buying deodorant, to getting a haircut, to filling up the car with gas, to buying a computer, to, you know, all the shit you would normally use on a daily basis, paying your tuition, paying your healthcare. But the CPI, the government numbers, they do a couple of things. They make adjustments to prices in these arbitrary ways where if they determine you're getting more quality the next year for the same amount of dollars, they might void out the price increase and say, all right, well, you're getting the benefit of the price increase back through the improved quality of the product or service. So that's one way they can make adjustments. And the second thing is they don't include everything that normal people spend money on in their calculations. Offhand, I can't tell you what they leave out, but I think they leave out like healthcare costs. They leave out college tuition, you know, things that, of course, are skyrocketing in price every year. So the government has a way to kind of fuck with the numbers. To make people think that inflation isn't really as bad as it actually is. There's really two ways to think about inflation. The old school definition, those old school guys 100 years ago, would tell you that inflation is the expansion of the money supply, which if you look up a chart of M2, which is essentially all of the money that's just floating around, the amount of dollars in creation, today, right? The actual amount of dollars that are out there floating around, that when that expansion, when that expands, that that's inflation. And the reasoning behind that is because just like with supply and demand, with everything else, the more of something you create, the less it is worth, right? So if the three of us have the only $3 in the country, we're fucking holding, you know, these incredible, amazing, instruments of purchasing power, right? But if 30 more people show up next to us and the central bank prints 30 more dollars for them, and now all of a sudden there's 33 people with dollars instead of just three people with dollars, our dollars are worth much less. And you just kind of expand that as the money supply expands, the dollars have less and less purchasing power, which is why if you look at a chart of, if you search for Fred, F-R-E-D, which is the Fed's macro data website. It's called Fred. But if you look at like the M2 chart for Fred, you see the money supply steadily going up. And if you look for purchasing power of the U.S. dollar on Fred, you see the dollar consistently going lower, which is why, you know, a cup of coffee cost fucking 10 cents 50 years ago, and today it's $7. They say it's inflation. What it really is it's the loss of purchasing power in the dollar. You need more dollars to get the same thing, right? So inflation happens, and really when people like you ask, well, when are we going to see it? What you're asking is like, when are we going to see what happened in Venezuela, which is this insane increase in consumer prices, right? When bread goes up to $50 a loaf, you know, in 2 weeks, like that kind of fucking crazy shit. And it's a really good question, because the Fed has created, if you're an old school purist, you think that the creation of the money in general is inflation, which I do. But for most people out there, even guys like Jim Rickards will say inflation really is an increase in prices. And until it's reflected in consumer prices, it doesn't really matter. And then the question is, where does that money go once it's created? A lot of the money that the Fed creates to stabilize the markets goes into these, you know, deposit accounts at large banks, and it's just never touched. So technically it's created and it's out there and it's part of the money supply, but it's not being moved around, right? So when you hear people talk about velocity of money, they're talking about how quickly a dollar goes from me to you, to your brother, back to me, to the taco stand. The taco guy takes it. He uses it to buy, you know, a case of beer. The, you know, the beer vendor takes it, pays one of his delivery drivers, and the dollar is just fucking going all over. But that's the velocity of money, right? Mm-hmm. And in order for consumer prices to rise, you need all of the money that's parked in these banks and institutions and all these places to hit, you know, consumer products and services and kind of make its way out there into the mainstream. And so the big $64,000 question is, when is any of this money that the government has created over the last 20 years going to do that? Are we going to see hyperinflation in prices? At some point, are we going to, you know, the money is all at the starting gate. At some point, is the gate going to open and the money finally going to make its way into consumer prices? What you see now is you see inflation in things like home prices, in like financial assets, in commodities. Now you see lumber's over, you know, $1,000 now for the first time ever. So while we're not seeing it in, you know, the price of milk just yet, it is starting to happen. Right. Inflation is out there. You just got to look in the right place. I've owned the house I'm in now for 5 years. And in the course of 5 years, it's appreciated like 28 or 30%, I think, based on the last comps for the same neighborhood. Right. That's inflation. That's price inflation. That, because if you're a buyer of homes, what that is to you is that's the price of houses going up, right? You're seeing inflation in home prices. As the homeowner, I don't mind it, right? Because at least in nominal terms, the value of the home is increasing. So you see it in financial assets. You see it in stocks. You see it in homes. You're starting to see it in commodities. Like I said, corn is skyrocketing. I think soybeans are at like near all-time highs. The price of uranium is really, really high right now. Lumber is really high. And so it's just a question of when it does hit that, when you do see it, you know, at the supermarket is what everybody says.
Right.
And you will at some point. It's just a question of when and how bad is it going to be when it happens. But the important thing, you know, is the money's out there somewhere. It's just got to make its way into the products that fuck your day up.
Very interesting, man.
What do you, in your, like, if you were to give advice to, you know, the 20-somethings, 30-somethings out there and beyond, whoever's listening, where are you parking money, or where are you funneling your own personal money as far as potential safe spots, growth spots?
I think the important thing is to get a definition of diversification that's different from what a financial advisor would tell you. And I'm not a financial advisor. I don't give financial advice, but this has been helpful to me personally. So I'll just speak about that. You know, when you go to a financial advisor and they tell you to diversify, generally what they'll say is like, put some money in some stocks and some bonds, and that's it, right? And really when people think about diversification, what they should think about is not just putting things in dollar denominated stocks and bonds, but also maybe owning other currencies, also owning emerging markets, owning commodities, things that, unlike the dollar, don't have an infinite supply, right? There's only so much oil on Earth. There's only so much gold on Earth. There's only so much, you know, at least until we can start to synthesize these things or we can mine asteroids or do those things. So any kind of commodity that has a finite supply, even real estate, right? There's only so much space on planet Earth. When you think about diversification, you know, it's great to own some stocks and some bonds. And hey, I own some stocks and bonds because the reality of the situation is we're in the system we're in. And, you know, you can either go with the flow or you could try to swim upstream. I like to try to do both because, you know, I spent many years trying to fight the central banking model now in terms of where I was putting my money. And it's just, it's a fruitless exercise for the most part. I have no doubt that the system that we are in is going to break at some point. And I don't know if it's going to be 10 years, 50 years, or 100 years. You know, we're using synthetic dollars to fucking, you know, we're printing fake money to buy things from other countries with debt. And we're not producing anything in this country. Mm-hmm. And really, we have a stock market and a real estate market. They're all just bubbles being propped up by this fake money that we're printing. We're not really producing anything in this country. And at some point, that charade has to end. I don't know what it looks like. I'm not a fucking econ professor at MIT. I'm not a specialist in game theory. But I just know that when that happens, if you own all U.S. stocks or all U.S. bonds, you're going to wind up getting fucked badly. I mean, maybe even those things go up in nominal terms if we hit hyperinflation. But in real terms, which is, you know, basically the discussion between purchasing power and the number of dollars that you have, right? The number of dollars you have might go up, but your purchasing power might go down. So when you say in real terms, that's what you're talking about. You're talking about exactly like how much does your purchasing power improve? Not just how much does the number on the sheet go up?